لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله
One particular thing that I wanted to cover though is with the sihr, with black magic. What happens with black magic is that black magic is haram. When a person commits that, they have to do it by going through something which is totally against the sharia. Okay? And when they do it, what they're doing is they're influencing jinns and they're bringing them and they're calling them to go out and to possess certain people, to be with them and to be over them and to take, you know, to do certain things. So for example, one of the key things that in that part of Surah Baqarah that I mentioned was to split a husband and wife. This is one sort of black magic the Quran speaks of. And I've been in London, there's one case that I was dealing with for 3 years. 3 years where we got, you know, I got other sort of specific shuyukh to deal with this case, and there was sihr involved in this, and the whole thing was just done just to get the husband and wife separated from one another, and in the end it actually just happened. But while it was, before they actually got separated, we managed to actually break the curse, we managed to break the sihr, and it was confirmed by 3 different sheikhs that I was dealing with at that time that it was broken. But there was also, you know, sihr is a much more violent form of what the influence of what a jinn can do under his normal influence. Because sihr, there is real violence. Now, these jinns that come with sihr, they are jinns that are not of a good nature at all. They're not of a good nature. And what happens is that for human beings to gain contact with these jinns, you know, the witchcraft that goes on, and there could be shirk involved in this, where people actually start to worship the devils, worship the shayateen. Now jinns are normal, but shayateen, obviously they're the evil ones, they're the devils. So they will start either worshipping them, calling them, and there will be all sorts of impure things that they could put together. So sometimes, you know, it's the blood of women's menses. Sometimes it's hair from one's private part. Sometimes it's, you know, blood. You know, sometimes it's, you know, dead animals. Sometimes it's graveyards. And whatever you can think of impure, sometimes it's fingernails, sometimes it's people's hair. You know, there's all sorts of witchcraft and black magic that can perform. But all of it ultimately starts off with very impure things that our Sharia tells us to stay away from or to get rid of. So with this, what happens, I mean, if anyone does this, you know, and there are people who do this out there. I mean, recently, I think in the 1990s, there's a massive cult that started in Egypt where certain people from even the West were going over there. And there was a cult that started as devil worshippers. You know, they would wear black and they would have long fingernails, or they would just stay with impurity, and they would worship these spirits, and they would worship sort of these creatures. And it came to an effect that the government had to ban this group. And you know, some of them believed that with the pyramids and with other sort of things, there are certain shayateen that could get released. Whatever the belief was, but across the world, in Africa you've got this, in the Indian subcontinent you've got this, in this country as well you've got this. And mainly people who do this, they will call other jinns to come together, and then they will send them off to a particular house or to a particular person to just cause evil. Now with sihr, it is a much more severe case than jinns. And with this, what needs to be done is, again, Quran is actually enough. If a person does it, if the person's immune system is high, if they're reading the Quran properly, if they're doing their ibadah properly, then they can actually break it off. They can actually break it off. But if a person is weak, then they will obviously be affected by it, and there could be severe effect. Now the effect can go from one to another. It can actually sometimes lead to death. It can sometimes lead to death. Sometimes it could lead to a person being mentally, you know, some of these mental patients, you know, these mentally ill people you got in hospitals. I would say you're a third of them perhaps, or maybe 20% of them might be sihr related or jinn related. maybe 70 to 80% of them might have true mental cases, because that's another thing that you have to be aware of. There are medical reasons for some people to go mad. There are actual medical reasons. Unless you explore both sides, you won't find out. Now, what happens normally is that when these cases come along to me and someone says to me that someone has been affected in this way and so on for a long time, and they say that doctors don't know what's happening, and they've done this test and that test, and they've gone from this specialist to that specialist, and there's been so many, you know, doctors that we referred to, but and so many months and perhaps years sometimes has passed, but they still can't find the cause. Most cases, it's to do with sihr or jinns, when doctors can't find at all. But you need to go to the doctors. You can't ignore that side, because sometimes it's medical. Sometimes it could be, you know, a nerve, it could be a medical condition, sometimes it could be a psychological condition. And unless that is explored, you can't really find out. Now, most of the cases that I have coming to me and I refer them on, again, I'm saying I refer them on, is that I will ask that question, you know, what have you done on the medical side? You know, have you actually explored that side yet or not? So then you send them off to someone. Now, if the case is positive, if the case is positive that they've got something, you normally find that straight away, because all you need to do is just sit there with a good sheikh, and when the sheikh starts to just recite, even sometimes they come near the sheikh, they'll start screaming, they'll start acting abnormal, or they'll start doing something sort of weird, or saying something, or they'll say, I'm not going. They'll just say, I'm not going. In strong cases, they'll, you know, you want to take them somewhere. Even if you try and trick them, you won't be able to trick them, because they know what you're up to. So they won't even make a move to go to that place. And where they're doing the exorcism now, they will start with Quranic ayats. And again, as I said to you, the Quran is still enough as a ruqya, but it depends on the person who's reciting it. And sometimes what happens is that then they're not able to accept with hours of recitation, or with multiple amounts of recitation. What I would say is, if you stick to the Quran, and I've seen this in many cases, if you stick to the Quran, you don't have to go to anything else to try and find the cure. There can be some severe, I've seen cases where I've been in close contact with one person who had sihr done on himself and his wife. And it was again to break them up. And they stayed on the Quran and they were reciting it. The more, you know, you really have to recite it and recite it and recite it. Alhamdulillah, eventually they're in a very good situation. Whereas one person who didn't recite it, you know, they actually ended up committing suicide, who was also affected. You know, they ended up committing suicide. What I want to say is that it is enough. However, some people do resort to other things. Now, when people resort to other things other than ruqya, you've got to be careful. Sometimes people could then go to places or people that could turn to shirk or something that is wrong. And you've got to look at the people that they're going to, because there's all sorts of people, and some people are out there just to take your money. Some people are out there for a business. So they just want to make money out of you, and you've got to be careful. A lot of the cases that I've found is they're out there for ingenuine reasons. How do you know that someone's not ripping you up? Well, the first thing is that the person shouldn't ask money off you. That's one of the first things one of the first signs I look for in a good sheikh, is that they shouldn't be asking money from you or fixing a price or doing something of that kind. Because when they do that, you know that that's not the first time they're gonna ask for money. نور على مر الزمان تألقا وأضاء للدنيا طريقا مشرقا وهدى من الرحمن يهدينا به للصالحات وللمكارم والتقى.